Hallelujah. That's in some ways, it's kind of a capsule of my life. He says, no matter how far you run, God still loves you. Hallelujah. Go ahead and turn the lights up, if you would, please. I was saved when I was about 17 in high school. I had a glorious conversion, to be honest with you. And then I went to college. And that was the beginning of the drop-off for 20 years. And my parents went through a sort of a very acrimonious divorce. And basically, in a capsule, I said, if this is God, then I don't want any part of it. And I did my own thing for a long, long time. But even though I ran away, I still knew God was real, still knew he was here, and somehow inside I knew he still loved me. So he, through his patience, he just let me do my own thing till there was no more of my own thing to do because I was at the bottom of the rung. How many of you have ever been there? Boy, I'm telling you, we all have a different rung, but it's the bottom. You know what I'm talking about? And the only way up is God. And I found, I looked up, I was living in Lakewood. I opened the Yellow Pages. That tells you how many years ago that was, because that's the only way you could find anything. They had no internet in those. The internet? What was that? You know? Found a Assemblies of God church in Lakewood, Colorado, that was near me. And I called and set an appointment with the pastor. And I had him pray with me, rededicated my life. Went to service that Sunday and just, you know, the rest is history, thank God. But you see, I tried both ways. And there's only one way. There's two ways, but one way's a hard way. I've been there. It's hard. You can do your own thing, but it's hard. And in the end, it's eternal separation from him. On the other hand, it's nothing but good and eternal fellowship with him. Amen? Hallelujah. Just felt like somebody needed to hear that. Well, let's get into the word that God has for us today. Let's begin by framing our world with our word. Say this after me. This is my Bible. The inspired and living word of God, given to all men for all ages. I am what it says I am. I have what it says I have, and I can do what it says I can do. As I'm taught the Word of God, I boldly declare that I have eyes that see, I have ears that hear, and my heart is open and receptive to the truth of God's Word. And I'll not only be a hearer, but I'll be a doer. I'll be a doer. I'll be a doer of the Word of God. And as I do, I know I will be blessed. Amen and amen. Well, praise the Lord. We're, I think, in week 9 of a series that we're calling Burn, Baby, Burn. Now, I know Ann and Craig can relate to this, but that was a slogan that came out of the 60s from a disc jockey in L.A., and it didn't really catch on until the Watts riots, until they started, every night they'd start marching around and burning and pillaging, just basic anarchy, and chanting the phrase, burn, baby, burn. Well, we've recycled the chant a little bit, and we're talking about in the Spirit and for the things of God and for the kingdom of God, burn, baby, burn. And we have been looking at specific kind of fuels that we need to have in our life to stay red hot and on fire for God. Amen? Now, last week, I'll give you the title. Today's title is Ablaze with Spiritual Authority. Ablaze, on fire with spiritual authority. Now, if you were with us last week, we established a biblical foundation concerning the subject of authority in our lives. And the very first truth that we discovered was that everyone on this planet, say everyone, is under authority in some form or another. Is that true? Amen. With that being true, we also saw that those that acknowledge and cooperate with that authority, things go well in their lives. Isn't that amazing? But on the other hand, or the other end of the spectrum, If you don't cooperate with authority, if you oppose that authority, you rebel against the authority in your life, folks, things are just not going to go well with you. There will be a price to pay. Come on, somebody. So we know that when God created this world that we live in, everything in it was ordered. Everything in it has been ordained with a sense of order and a sense of decency. Come on, somebody, all right? Am I speaking to anybody here? Am I speaking the truth today? Hallelujah. And really, this topic could not be more relevant than it is today. Amen. Oh, by the way, I received my ballot, my absentee ballot yesterday. I'm excited about that. On Colorado, we have 21 different candidates on the presidential ticket, including Kanye West, if you can believe that. So anyway, I know who I'm voting for. How about you? I'm voting for the man that God put in there 4 years ago. Amen? Hallelujah. Anyway, this topic could not be more relevant for us today because we know that we're living in the end of the age. Amen? And because we are living in the last days, the result of what you and I are witnessing in our country is a disregard for authority, and it is becoming pandemic. That's a word we're all familiar with, right? It's becoming pandemic in our society, across our society. Why is this happening? Well, the Bible clearly tells us that that at some point our society will discard all of the age-old, biblically agreed-upon moral standards and absolutes that has guided our country for centuries until a point where rebellion reaches its maximum point in the heart of our society and in this end-time world. But the good news is we can live apart from that, and I won't get ahead of myself here. But if you haven't, well, let me say it this way. If you have not recognized this yet, the fact that God Himself has placed Donald J. Trump in the White House is evidence of His great mercy towards this country to at least delay what is or will be inevitable. And that will be a society full of rebellion and anarchy and violence. But it does not have to affect our lives. Come on, somebody. So if you missed last week's message, I'd encourage you. You know, you can go to our Faith Life Fellowship Facebook page or to our YouTube page. Watch the message from last week, because much of what I'm about to talk about today is going to be based on that foundation that we established last week. So let's continue on talking about the subject of spiritual authority. Okay, so how many here are born again? Hallelujah. Hopefully that's every hand here. Amen. Well, if you're a born-again believer in Jesus Christ, then you are under authority to Him first. Okay? Jesus Christ, as the head of the church, is the ultimate authority in our lives. Not the government. Not the state of Colorado, you know, not the county that you live in. Jesus is the ultimate authority in our lives. Amen? Hallelujah. In fact, unless you submit to His authority, even from the beginning, it is impossible for you to receive or even experience salvation. Look at Romans 10:9 with me. I'm going to read this in the Passion Translation. Romans chapter 10 and verse 9, it says this. And what is God's living message? Well, it's the revelation of faith for salvation, which is the message that we preach. For if you publicly declare with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, and you believe in your heart that God raised Him from the dead, what is the result? You will experience salvation. How many have done that? Praise God for that. Amen. When you publicly declare that Jesus Christ is Lord, what you are doing is you are expressing the thought, you are saying, here is one who has the ultimate and the supreme authority in my life. That's what the word Lord means. I think I have a definition for that. Is it up there? Hallelujah. There it is right there. Lord means one who has the ultimate and the supreme authority in another man's life or in another person's life. In other words, your entrance into the kingdom of God and your personal relationship with Christ Himself is rooted in submission to His absolute authority. Does that make sense? Okay. So as we continue here to discuss what is required to stay on fire for God, one of the other fuels, it is essential for us to understand this key truth, and this is the fuel I'm going to talk about today, and we can put this up on the screen. Here's the key truth. If you want the power and fire of God to flow through you, it is imperative that you are aligned under Christ's absolute authority. Because, see, anything in your life that gets out of order with Christ's rightful position of authority, it will disrupt the flow of heaven through you into the earth. Come on, somebody. We talked about this a few weeks ago, if you remember. We talked about the power. How does God manifest His power? Well, we simply, as believers, are a conduit. That God in heaven can reach, we can reach up to heaven with one hand. His power can flow through us and be delivered through us to the person who has a need. We're like an electric wire, a conduit, where the power of God flows to the person that's in need. So when we pray or when we lay hands on a person, the power of God comes from heaven, it comes through us, and it comes into the person in need, right? But when we get out of alignment with God, it curtails that power. That's why being in submission to His authority is so important. Hallelujah. So it's critical for every single one of us to discover any area of our lives, listen now, that's out of sync, and put our attention to that area until we come back into divine alignment. When we get into alignment, then the power of God is able to flow on a continuous basis. And the result is we stay on fire for the kingdom and for the things of God. Amen? All right. Go over with me to Acts chapter 2. In verse 42, I'm going to read to you out of the Amplified Classic. It says, "And they steadfastly persevered." If you have Amplified, I'd underline that, steadfastly persevered. It says, devoting themselves, what? Constantly to the instruction and the fellowship of the apostles, to the breaking of bread, including the Lord's Supper, which, of course, we did this morning, and to prayers. Let me read it again. And they steadfastly persevered, devoting themselves constantly to the instruction and fellowship of the apostles, to the breaking of bread, including the Lord's Supper, and prayers. So what were they doing? They steadfastly, what'd they do? Persevered. See, steadfastly means to persevere consistently. Not just now and then, consistently. Did you hear that word? In my own opinion, here's where many Christians miss the mark. And this idea, because this idea here, it carries an idea of this very intense focus combined with a four-letter word, hard work. Hard work. Intense focus combined with hard work. A lot of Christians don't like that part. I'm just telling you the truth. Amen? But right here, this tells me that the early believers, when they came together in these early meetings, much like what we have right here today, when they came into that meeting, watch this, they intentionally set their hearts to listen and to learn from the apostles' teaching and the preaching of the Word of God. It says they steadfastly persevered. In fact, if you do a little study of that word steadfastly, it carries such a strong meaning. It also can signify that the, and this is one we can relate to, that the early apostles were actually addicted to the spiritual authority of the apostles to such an extent that they gathered to hear and receive from them, not weekly, every single day. Is that what it says? I'm telling you, folks, in this day and age, for many people, being in church 4 or 5 times a month would be a record for them. I'm just telling it like it is. Don't get mad at me. Hallelujah. Every day? Are you serious? See, one of the words that we're all familiar with, that the Bible talks a lot about, uses a lot, is the word disciple. Anybody ever heard that term before? Of course we have. We all like to think of ourselves as being a disciple. Is that right? Hallelujah. Well, just hold that slide for a minute here, Janet, please. Hallelujah. The Greek definition of this word conveys something that would actually eliminate many people in the church world today. Go ahead now, put it up. It says, a disciple depicts a student who is in complete submission to a teacher who has a master's influence in his life. Let me read that again. A disciple is a student who is in complete submission to a teacher who has a master's influence in his life. And that mastery in the life of a true disciple, it means that the disciple is bound to obey anything and everything that the teacher requires. That's what a disciple is, okay? With that said, again, to be a disciple means that you follow and you obey every teaching and every direction that he gives to you. See, to me, this is the difference between what I would call a follower of Christ and a disciple of Christ. A disciple is one who explicitly follows whatever Jesus asks them to do. Are you seeing the difference today? Go over with me to John 13. We'll put it up on the screen for you. And I'm going to look at verse 13. This is the Passion Translation. Jesus himself is talking here, so if you have a red letter edition, of course, the letter should be red. But John 13:13 in the Passion says, and Jesus said this, says, you've called me teacher and Lord, and you're right, for that's who I am. I am your teacher, and I'm also your Lord. He's acknowledging that the disciples, when they called him Lord, when they did that, they were absolutely correctly in acknowledging who he was in their lives. Amen? In other words, Jesus was and is the supreme master. And what was supposed to happen, as the master taught them, each one of them, each one of those disciples, each one of you and I today are called to play a part alongside the master. Okay? You could say it like this. Jesus was the conductor, and each of them, as the orchestra, had a specific part to play. And when they did that, it produced what you'd call a great symphony, led by the indisputable conductor himself, who directed every step and every note they played. How important is that? Well, I want to, in my weak little way of doing it, I want to try and demonstrate the difference here. So I have 2 sound bites I want to play with you. The first sound bite now is, let me make sure here, this is the sound bite of an orchestra warming up, okay? Now, notice that they all begin on the same note because they have to tune their instruments, so they're all, you know, in this, what would you call that? There's a term for it. So all the instruments are, when you play the note, it's all in the same unison or key, whatever. I'm not sure what the exact way to say that is. But notice, as they warm up, there's no real unity. Then the sound produced is not very distinct. In fact, it's all over the board. Now go ahead and play that. Make sure we got some good volume here. Reminds me of several churches that I know. Now let's compare that to an orchestra that's being led and is following the conductor, and notice the difference in sound when everyone is following the conductor. Go ahead. Hallelujah. I like those in the orchestras. But notice what the one thing, that when all of those musicians are in submission to the conductor, did you notice the sound that got released through them? Amen? Now, of course, this is just an earthly example of a heavenly concept. But if we're going to be on the team, if you're going to be on the team, and you're going to be considered a disciple, it's going to require total devotion. It's going to require submission. It's going to require respect for spiritual authority and the leadership that God has entrusted to him to exercise over his disciples. Okay? Take Judas Iscariot for a moment. He decided to do his own thing, did he not? He rebelled against Christ's authority. He rebelled against his submission to his leadership. He decided to go in a different direction. The result was he was removed from the team. Amen? Don't miss this. You can't choose to do your own thing and expect to be part of the team and to be used in an extraordinary way. I've been in church long enough, and I've heard this, I can't tell you how many times, from people. Well, you know, I don't need a church. I don't need a pastor. Jesus is my Lord. And I just, you know, I can go out in the forest, or I can go to the lake, and I can just have communion with the Lord. I don't need to be in under authority to anybody but Jesus himself. Well, it sounds wonderful, sounds very religious, sounds very spectacular. It's completely false. They need to be under submission and under authority to the spiritual authorities that God has placed in his life. If he would, it will go well with him. Amen? What I'm saying, you can't choose to do your own thing, do it your own way, then expect to be part of the team and expect God to use you in extraordinary ways. It doesn't work like that. Hallelujah. You can't be in church on one Sunday, miss the next two Sundays, as is the habit of many believers today, and they think that there's nothing wrong with that. Now, I'm not judging anybody. I'm not trying to degrade anybody, make you feel bad. But if you're not in church on a regular basis, there's a problem with that. Yeah, people go on vacation. Yes, once in a great while we have conflicts that arise. I understand, though I'm not talking about those kind of situations, okay? It's this overall week-to-week attendance that is so poor among many people who call themselves Christians across the board. I'm not talking about this church. I'm talking about across the board. Amen? And I believe the prophecy that the Lord spoke through my wife this morning is an example of that. Come back. Come back. Come back to my church. Come back to the pastor or the leader or the teacher who I've placed you under. Come back into submission. Come back into authority. Come back into compliance. Come back into accountability. Come back and be a part of the team. That's what God was saying today through you, hon. I believe that. You know, there's one thing that still amazes me. As many years as I've done, I can't get this settled in my brain for anything. And it's believers who have unbelieving relatives. And those relatives come to town to visit, you know, and the week before we get a text or we get a voicemail. I'm sure you probably got it too. Pastor, I just wanted to let you know, we have some family members coming into town this week, so we won't be in church on Sunday. What? You have your unbelieving family coming to visit you. You have an opportunity to take them to church, to be a witness to them, and you're going to decide to do something else on that Sunday. Am I telling the truth as pastors? That makes no sense to me. I mean, if you can help me with it, please. See, I appreciate their accountability. I appreciate them taking the time to say, we're not going to be there. Yes, that is important too. But what I can understand is when they have an opportunity to witness to their family by making church a priority, they don't do it. And they become just like the world. We're having fun now, aren't we? Just smile. Just smile, look straight ahead, say, praise God, he's not talking about me. John 13, Jesus said, you called me teacher and Lord, and you're right, for that's who I am. Amen. See, this is what this definition that we gave you, this is what was meant by using the word Lord 2,000 years ago, and this is what is meant by using the word Lord, that it still means the same thing today for you and me. If you say, Jesus, you are the Lord of my life, okay, what you are saying is that, Jesus, you have absolute authority in my life, and I am submitted to you. I will obey whatever you will ever ask me to do. I am your servant to command. I can tell you right now, 90% of church congregations across this country would not want to hear what I just said. Why? Because it goes against their agenda, their wants, what they want to do for their life. They don't want to be under authority. They don't want to be told what to do, when to do it, how to do it. They want to do their own thing and think that they can just, kind of skip along, and in the end it's all going to be okay. I don't think that's the case. The Lord said this morning, come back. Come back. Hallelujah. I learned this many years ago from Brother Copeland. I mean, I don't know how many times I've heard it said. When he's talking about prayer and talking about his fellowship with God, he gets up there and he says, sir, yes, sir, I am yours to command. Just like he was in the army or in the armed forces of some sort. Sir, I am yours to command. That's really what each of us should be doing. Amen? Hallelujah. Let's remind ourselves for a moment. Turn over to Colossians chapter 1. I want to remind ourselves for a moment of what the Holy Spirit has said through the Apostle Paul concerning this subject. And this scripture that we're about to read is speaking specifically about Jesus and his supremacy. Okay? Do we understand that? Colossians 1 verse 15, this is the Passion Translation. Again, it's talking about the supremacy of Christ. It says, he is the divine portrait. The Amplified Classic says, he is the exact likeness of the unseen God. He is the divine portrait, the true likeness of the invisible God, and the firstborn heir of all creation. For through the Son, everything was created, both in the heavenly realm and on the earth, all that is seen and all that is unseen, every seat of power, realm of government, principality, and authority. It was all created through Him and for His purpose. He existed before anything was made, and now everything finds completion in Him. He is the head of His body, which is the church. And since He is the beginning and the firstborn heir in resurrection, He is the most exalted one, holding first place in everything. Hallelujah. That same truth remains today, 2,000 years later. Jesus is the believer's ultimate authority, and He continues to carry out His lordship over you and me, the church. Amen? And let's take it one step further. He carries out His lordship through the spiritual authority established inside the church to help Him. And of course, that spiritual authority are the ones that He has called and anointed to lead the church in its various capacities. What are those? Turn over to Ephesians chapter 4. Ephesians 4, verse 11, again in the Passion this morning. And He, talking about Jesus, has appointed some with grace to what? Be apostles. And some with grace to be prophets. And some with grace to be evangelists. And some with grace to be pastors. And some with grace to be teachers. And their calling, now watch this, their calling is to nurture and prepare all of the holy believers to do their own works of ministry, and as they do, they will enlarge and build up the body of Christ. It's like having the main conductor and the main orchestra, but all on the side you have minor orchestras and conductors too. They're getting all the orchestras ready on the side so that at one point we all come together with the master conductor. Hallelujah. All of these leaders that you see here, the apostle, the prophet, the evangelist, the pastor, the teacher, all of these people, all of these offices, I should say, have been chosen to work alongside Him, and they are to be in complete submission to Jesus as the supreme head of the church. And their calling, my calling, Pastor JoJo's calling, Craig and Ann's calling, hallelujah, is to prepare all of the holy believers to do their own works of ministry. Hallelujah. I'm preaching better than your amening. I like the way, this is the way Rick Renner describes this order. He says this, when we are aligned under Christ's authority and under the local spiritual authority He has set over us, that alignment enables us to be channels through which God's power can freely flow. Hallelujah. Do we have that up there? Or what's happened to our... Did it go south? There we go. On the other hand, if we're out of sync with God's established system, spiritual debris can accumulate to clog the channel, disrupt the flow of God's power, and ultimately snuff out our own spiritual fire. Remember, we're talking about burn, baby, burn. Fuel that will keep us on fire spiritually for God. And one of those is aligning ourselves in submission and under the authority that God has placed in our lives. Now think back a moment just, you know, to the symphony examples we heard. Every believer must learn to play their part and play it well according to the direction of the spiritual conductor to whom God has assigned to their life. Okay? And if you will willingly recognize and respect your conductor's authority and follow their directions, you then become a part of a great symphony that produces this powerful blended sound in accomplishing God's plan in the earth. Hallelujah. But on the other hand, if you decide to sidestep that spiritual authority, you decide to disregard their leadership, what happens is you produce a discordant sound compared to the rest of the orchestra, and that sound has detrimental consequences. Hallelujah. Well, we're having fun today. Hallelujah. So what we've seen to this point, if I can summarize it, is that submission to authority is an inescapable part of our lives. And this includes submission to spiritual authority for any Christian who wants to be a true disciple. Turn over to Hebrews 13, please. Hallelujah. God is getting us ready for something big. And I'm telling you, it's not decades down the road. I don't believe it's even years down the road. It's months at best, maybe even weeks. Come on, somebody. Hebrews 13, verse 7 in the King James, he says, "Remember them which have the rule over you." Go ahead and just underline that word rule. We'll come back to that in a minute. "Remember them which have the rule over you, who have spoken unto you the word of God, whose faith follow, considering the end of their conversation." Now again, this is, you know, in the King James, it's a little hard to follow, kind of interpret what exactly is being said here. But let's just break it down for a few minutes. He says, "Remember them which have the rule over you." In other words, that word rule, it means the one who has a leading or a visible position of influence in your life. So you could read it like this. Remember them that have a leading or visible position of influence in your life. You are to remember them. Okay? Now, as we get into this, let me preface with this statement. There are no perfect leaders. None. I don't care who you admire, there are no perfect leaders. So get that out of your head, okay? Any spiritual leader can, has, or will make a mistake now and then, okay? However, those with spiritual authority over others must be those who are allowing the Holy Spirit to take them even further, take them even deeper, take them even higher in their walk with God. Those are the spiritual leaders that you want to have over your life. Amen? So again, he says, we are to remember those that have the rule, those that have a spiritual influence on our lives, those people who are leading with a visible influence. And then he goes on to say, who have spoken to you the word of God. To me, this makes it clear that those whom God has sent to be a spiritual authority in your life are those who are tasked with a regular speaking of the word of God to you. Okay? In other words, it's referring to those who teach, who preach, and instruct you the most regularly in the word of God. Okay? In other words, that means that whoever has your ear, watch this, whoever has your ear has influence in your life. Whoever has your ear. Okay? And as the scripture says to us, these must be those whose faith you are confident to follow. Now, in the RIV version, that's probably new to most of you, this is the Renner Interpretive Version. I don't know if you've heard about it. He's coming out with it. But the RIV, it's easier to say RIV. Defining this word follow, it says, it implies an intentional study of the life, the deeds, actions, and thoughts of another person in an attempt to fully understand that person, then to imitate or duplicate his attributes in one's own life. In other words, you should be so impressed by the faith and the godly character of that spiritual leader who has your ear that you are willing to do whatever that person asks you to do. Scripturally. Okay? Let me say it another way. Help me here, Lord. You are so impressed by the faith and the godly character of that spiritual leader who has your ear in your life that you personally are willing to do whatever that person does to be like him or her. That's a better way to put it. Does that make sense? If you don't respect that leader, and I'm a bottom line guy today. If you don't respect that leader enough to replicate his life or her life of faith and character, then number one, you need to stop and you need to determine and figure out why not. Where is the first place that you need to look? It's not a trick question. Inside. You need to examine yourself first. Okay? First and foremost, examine yourself. Make sure that you are not the problem and that the lack of respect that you have for this particular leader doesn't lie with you. Okay? Number two, then. But if your heart is clear concerning that area and you still have concluded that that leader's life in God and before man is not an example that you desire to replicate in your own life, my question to you this morning is this. Why are you still committed to that church? And why are you still connected to that leader? I told you, it's going to be a bottom line message. Come on, somebody. If you cannot respect that leader's life enough to replicate his life or her life or their example of their walk with God in your own life, then that leader just doesn't qualify to be a spiritual authority in your life. And you need to go somewhere else. A real God-given spiritual authority in your life will be a person who you desire to follow and who you desire to imitate. Hallelujah. Let's go back to Hebrews 13 again. Remember them which have the rule over you, who have spoken unto the word of God, whose faith follow, considering the end of their conversation. So let's take apart the second part of this. He says, considering the end of their conversation. So consider, it simply means to observe accurately or to consider well. But in the end here, the end describes how a person steps forward or makes progress in life. So in essence, again, using the REV, Hebrews 13 warns you to earnestly contemplate, observe and carefully consider the way those who lead you are making progress in their own lives. In other words, the easiest way to say it, look at their lives, make sure that what they are is what you want to be. It's that simple. We're commanded to follow only those who have a faith and a life that's worthy of being imitated. But again, remember this. There are no perfect leaders, none. So don't look for a perfect leader. If they make a mistake, they make a mistake. They need to repent, and they need to acknowledge it and move on. But that's not a reason to disassociate yourself. Come on, somebody. Hallelujah. Drop down to verse 17 in that same chapter. Hebrews 13, 17. So he continues to say, so what we're supposed to do, he says, obey them that have the rule over you. The rule is the same word that we saw in verse 7. Obey them that have the rule over you and submit yourselves, for they watch for your souls as they that must give an account, that they may do it with joy and not with grief, for that is unprofitable for you. Even as I read that, the anointing just overwhelmed me. I'll explain later. I don't want to. I need to keep this first. The rule. It's the same verse, same word used in verse 7. It's talking about one who has a leading or visible position of influence in your life. So obey the rule. But when you make that decision on who that person is, then you are to obey them that have the rule over you. Again, quoting Rick Renner on this subject, this is him, and I quote, this word is used to tell us that we need to have rock solid certainty about who is supposed to hold a position of spiritual authority in our lives and to who we are to be in submission. This is a very important issue, and we each must come to a place where we are assured that we are in submission to the correct person or persons. Then once that assurance is obtained, we are to submit to our spiritual leaders. Now, folks, I'm just being totally honest. This is a very difficult subject for many people to hear in this modern day and age that we live in. People in general do not want to be in submission to anyone's rule or authority, any established order, any established authority. But yet, it is a key fuel in sustaining a life that stays on fire for God. So let's talk about submission for just a minute, can we? You know, I've been to weddings where they take that word out of the wedding ceremony. You know, when I'm talking about wives, submit yourselves to your husbands. Well, they think that, you know, that it's just this very weak person and they just go and he's cracking the whip. But nothing could be farther from the truth. The reason a woman can submit to the leadership of her husband is because she has complete confidence, complete authority, complete peace in her heart that he is going to seek God with all his heart. And he's only going to do what God says, and he's only going to do what God says. So she willingly makes a decision to submit herself under that leadership and authority. It's not this, do what I say, woman. Oh, please. All right, let's just go on. So as we study this word submit, or we study the word or the subject submission, it describes an individual, watch this, who has willingly placed himself or herself under authority. Did you see the key? Did you catch the key word there? Willingly placed themselves. Where? Under authority. The way that I could describe it in the natural is very much like a military soldier who voluntarily submits himself under the authority and the watchful eye of a commanding officer. Now, this soldier may not like the commanding officer's personality. He may not like the way he talks, the way he speaks, the way he tweets. Are you catching my drift? He may not like the way he gives his orders, but folks, that is irrelevant. They never ask a soldier whether he likes or dislikes his commanding officer. He is expected to respect him and to honor him. If you disrespect your commanding officer, you are out of order. And punishment follows right behind that kind of an attitude. quickly in the military. The reason that this illustration is so important for us today as we study this New Testament word submit is that the very context that this word submit is used in the New Testament is from the standpoint of a military environment. Submission to authority occurs when a person respectfully recognizes his position under the leadership of one placed in authority over him. Whether it's at work, at school, at church, at home, in a marriage, or in any other sphere of life. Let's look at our scripture again, one more time. Obey them that have the rule over you and submit yourselves. Why? For they watch for your souls as they that must give an account, that they may do it with joy and not with grief, for that is unprofitable for you. There is one more way that you can recognize those who hold a position of spiritual authority over you and over your life, and it says it right here, for they watch for your souls. This is a picture, folks, of someone who is mindful about someone else. One Christian leader said it like this, and I quote, "The true leader is concerned primarily with the welfare of others, not with his own comfort or prestige." I cannot think of a more fitting word to describe one with spiritual authority in someone else's life. A true leader is concerned primarily with the welfare of others. See, a true spiritual leader is going to care more about his flock than he will for himself. Why? Because he believes that he is spiritually responsible for that individual. And at some point, watch this, he must give an account to God for you. He must give a full report and be answerable to his superior for you. This means, folks, that just as you will have to personally answer for how well you have followed those God has entrusted to have authority in your life, those he's called to lead you spiritually will also have to give an account to Jesus for the way they have led your life. Serious, serious business on both sides of the coin. Come on, somebody. And I'm going to make a statement, and I'm in no way am negative or derogatory, it's simply a fact. Some people can be a grief to lead. I pray that it not be you. We're having some fun now, Craig. We are all commanded to obey and to voluntarily submit to our spiritual leaders with joy, so that situation will not turn out to be a grief for those who are leading and unprofitable for those who are being led. Let me say that again. We are all commanded to obey and voluntarily submit to our spiritual leaders. Why? So that the situation will not turn out to be a grief for those who are leading and unprofitable for those being led. Let me share just one firsthand experience for you today. This is over a decade ago when we first began our church down in Castle Rock, and I think there's only one couple here that was there at this point, so no one's going to know who I'm talking about, and that's good. We appointed a gentleman who had appeared to be faithful. Notice the word appeared. We appointed him to head up our AV side of the church, and so he basically oversaw the people who were running the computers and the sound and the video and all that. And while it wasn't immediately visible to us, that as time went along, we kept hearing and seeing little things that sort of indicated that this man had a problem with our leadership, okay? And sure enough, it all came to a head one afternoon when he sent me this very lengthy email detailing every single step, everything that was wrong with the church, everything that was wrong with our leadership, how it could be improved, how we needed to change this, how we needed to change that, and so forth. Well, I could have probably taken it a little better than I did, but I'm just being honest with you. It really ticked me off. And I wrote him back a scathing email. I'm not saying that was right, but that's what I did. And he didn't like my response. So he left the church. Okay? But to be honest with you, we should have been on the lookout for this exact problem, because when he first called me, came to our state from another state, found us online, and so he wanted to meet with the pastor and find out about the church, and, you know, something he wanted to join. Well, it's interesting, during that lunch, he told me the exact same scenario that he'd encountered with the pastor in the previous church that he'd left. So here we have the same situation, the same scenario repeating itself over and over again, except a different church and a different pastor. I've since hopefully gotten a little smarter. Well, after he left, the people in the sound booth, we both found out, they were relieved, because this is what was happening every Sunday. He would tell them, pastor wants this, and he wants this that way, and he wants you to do this, but here's the way we're going to do it. We're going to do it my way. This was happening every Sunday. And of course, it made him feel very uncomfortable and uneasy, and it should have, because this man was in rebellion. He was not in submission to our leadership. Hebrews 13:7 right here tells us that if you nurture an inappropriate attitude towards that person's spiritual authority, it will be unprofitable for you. Why? Because of your wrong attitude towards spiritual authority. It will not be in your best interest. One more example. We just recently, again, I'm not going to name any name, we had a person leave this church. And the reason was their complete failure to recognize the spiritual authority over them and respond in a respectful and in a gracious manner. And I can assure you, it was not in that person's best interest for that to happen, but it was their choice. Okay? Are we having fun now? The issue of spiritual authority is vital for your spiritual health. It's vital for the strength of the church and to the strength of each individual believer who makes up that church. Every person needs to be under spiritual authority. Pastor Judge and I are under spiritual authority. We don't do this thing on our own. Hallelujah. But here's why you want to do this. When you willingly submit yourself to that spiritual authority, there is a miraculous and a mutual exchange of strength that occurs in that relationship. And God supernaturally connects people together to mutually benefit each and every one of them. It's His plan, not man's. And this is God's desire for all of His children, including you and including me. What is the benefit of doing this? Well, for years, I've said this. And I'll say it again. I said it, I think, a week or two ago. If this is your home church, if God has called you to be a member of Faith Life Fellowship, then this is your wealthy place. And again, just like my wife said this morning, we're not talking about just finances. We're talking about healing and protection and wisdom and grace and mercy and revelation and anything that the enemy would try to bring to you, you are protected because you've been placed in the ark of God. How do I know that? Psalm 92, verse 13. Those that be planted in the house of the Lord shall flourish in the courts of our God. Those that be planted. Every Christian needs to be planted in the house of the Lord. He has a place for you. And that place is a place of flourishing in the courts of God Himself. To be planted and flourishing is one of the greatest blessings of submitting yourself to spiritual authority under which God places you. There is nothing greater in your life. And if you're going to stay on fire, if you're going to be on fire and stay on fire, you must learn how to come under that spiritual authority that God has established in your life. This is why the early church experienced such power and such spiritual fire, that they steadfastly persevered, coming daily into the presence of the apostles to hear and learn of the Word of God. And the result was miracles and signs and wonders that shook the city. Hallelujah. But as we approach the end of the age, where lawlessness in our society is throwing off all forms of authority and is screaming for independence, God is calling His people to come back into alignment with spiritual authority. There it is right there, in my own words. God is calling His people to come back. I just saw it. That's the Holy Ghost. God is calling His people to come back into alignment. Come under the spiritual authority He's created for your safety, for your well-being, for your ability to flourish in His courts. If you think that this defund the police, when I first heard it, I said, that's got to be the stupidest idea I think I've ever heard in my entire life. But if you think it just happened by accident, it is not an accident. This is a concerted effort by the forces of darkness to throw off all the restraints that we've had in this country and enter into an age of lawlessness. And it is going to get worse. I'm not trying to be negative. I'm just telling you, read your Bible. Come on, somebody. But here's the good news. God knows that when His house is in order, regardless of what's happening in the society around you, increase will come. Promotion will come. Protection will come. Revelation will come. Healing will come. Why? You're in alignment. And the result is the church in the last days will come ablaze with the power and with the fire of God and see the greatest revival the earth has ever witnessed. And then the end shall come. That's why, and this will be, I've already told you, this is going to be my next series called That's Why You Can Survive and Thrive in a World Gone Nuts. We are called to not only to survive, but to thrive, even in a world that's gone nuts, that's gone crazy, that's entered into a lawless age. Hallelujah. But it's going to take the church to come back and to realign itself under the spiritual authority, under the spiritual leaders that God has prepared for this hour. And I'm talking about the church across the board. And the result is that millions of people will come to know God, will call upon Jesus as their Lord and Savior, and then the end will come. I read yesterday, there's what, almost 8 billion people now on the planet. They estimate about 3 billion are believers, and that's including Catholics. And, you know, I know that there are believing Catholics and there are some unbelieving Catholics. So there are some people that God is wanting to be added to his kingdom. Amen. Hallelujah. Did you learn something today? Praise. Why don't you stand up? Hallelujah. Pray for you. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. You know, in 1 Timothy, chapter 4, verse 13, he says, "Till I come," this is the Lord talking, "devote yourself to public and private reading, to exhortation, to preaching and personal appeals, and teaching and instilling doctrine." Preach and instill doctrine. It's never been more important. The basics, the fundamentals of our faith have never been more important. If you have this attitude, well, I know all that, let's get into some deep revelation. No, that is the deep revelation. Having faith for salvation, the laying on of hands, water baptism, you know, all these things, spiritual authority, all these things are so important to our lives. So, Father, we're thanking you. Thanking you, Lord, that we have not been deceived, that we have called upon Jesus to be our Lord and Savior, but at the same time, we understand that that does not necessarily mean that we are in spiritual alignment with your plan for our lives. So I ask you, Lord, to speak to every person, every heart. Lord, only you know where they are. Only you know where they need to be. Only you know the changes they need to make. And I'm thanking you, Lord, that you are a faithful God and that you will faithfully speak to every person to make any kind of changes, whether it be physical, emotional, mental, spiritual, whatever that change is, that they will do it confidently as they humble themselves before you. And Lord, the result of that humbleness, Lord, will be that your mighty power will work in them in extraordinary ways. And as they align themselves spiritually under the leadership that you have placed them in, Lord, they will flourish and grow and multiply and come up to a level they've never experienced in the courts of their God. So we're thanking you today for this message. Although it wasn't an easy one to hear, Lord, we know that you've brought it to us because you love us, because you care for us, and because you want us to make those changes in our life that will benefit us. And so, Lord, we openly receive it. We thank you for it. And again, Satan, I come against you. I come against any lying spirit, any deceiving spirit, any spirit of strife and division. I come against you. I take authority over you. And I command you to go from this church, go from every individual in this church, and we will only have a unity of the Spirit and of the faith. And we will willingly make the changes that you show us to make in our lives. And the result is that we shall flourish in the courts of our God. Thank you, Lord, for planting us. Thank you for the plans and purposes that you have instituted for our lives. And thanking that is indeed your will and your wish that we flourish. And we give you all the praise and all the glory in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Well, we love you. God loves you. And Jesus is Lord.
I just want to share something I read this week from a reliable source. From a pastor's perspective, a conservative denomination.